Let's open the door for women in uniform everywhere. DIG Seema Dhundia and Assistant Commandant Ishita Chauhan.
Again, thanks to Barkha, I'm here because I've never moderated a panel. And I think the only qualification, so to say, that I have is she told me you're a Fauji kid. The truth is, the average Fauji kid is quite the brat and unlikely to. But you know what? I am so overwhelmed to be sharing the stage with two incredible women. All I want to start by is, you have met DIG Seema on the stage.
I've been introduced so many times, I was thinking that probably the people may lose interest in my conversation, like they would be interested in listening to Ishita more, but okay, yeah.
I am just honored and overwhelmed to be sharing the stage here. But ma'am, do I call you ma'am or is there a...
You can call me by my name, Seema. That would be more friendlier.
I insist that my team calls me by ma'am. Hierarchy rehta hai, wo fauji wala background I take there. But
Ishita would call me ma'am, but you can call me Seema.
I understand that I'm not very conversant, with the whole background, but I know that Seema has been one of the first women in the forces of CRPF, which is our largest paramilitary force. I came from a background where my father was a naval officer. And yet, despite the fact that 1987 was the first batch, I think the current statistics indicate that we still have only close to 3% of women in the forces. They're lost completely, you know. And at the same time, pioneers like Seema, who have gone and led, I hear. Girls, we are in a school and, I love the fact that my band thinks I'm the school teacher kind of a character. Will you not make so much of noise, please? I find this tough. I find it much easier to sing. But I hear that, ma'am, you led the all-women's force under the UN forces in Liberia. And Liberia is one of the most dangerous places in the world. So she led the all-women international forces. out there?
In fact, we went under the UN banner there. We were working for UN, United Nations. It was an all-formed female police unit. That was for the first time in the history of UN and even in the history of government of India. Like, for the first time, they were sending their troops on a mission like this to a country like Liberia, which was totally conflict-ridden state. And there were people and children, girls who were victims post civil war and so. So the situation was really bad when we landed. It was way back in 2007. And sometimes I wonder, because I thought that I'm doing my duty, whatever that was assigned to me and that was I was told to do. But I never knew that this going to Liberia will be creating a history. And still the accolades are pouring in. That is quite a situation which sometimes I fail to tackle as to why these accolades are still pouring in. I went there in 2007. It's almost, 12, 13 years. But still people are saying about it, talking about it. So it's nice to hear such things.
In terms of your experience there on the field, because it's one thing that right now there's this rise of, I don't know, a lot of identity politics. And for me as a person, as I was discussing with you backstage, I don't see the world as black and white, although I'm wearing it. There are a lot of grays out there, and not all men are terrible, and not all women are saints. I mean, we have a mixture of all kinds there. So, but when you were handling an all-women's force in, say, a Liberia, could you share any anecdote which made you believe that it's like one might assume that handling a battalion of men would be a very different thing from handling a battalion of women. And most people would like to assume that maybe women are easier because somehow we are seen to be the softer, easier gender. Is there any truth in that?
Let me clarify, Sona, that I have commanded a male battalion also, and I have commanded the female battalions as well. What I feel, commanding a female battalion is much more difficult than commanding a male battalion. Because while dealing with women, you are not, as a Fauji, we are trained to give orders like, do this, you have to move tomorrow, pack your bags, be ready in 10 minutes or within half an hour. So for a normal male battalion, you can pass on these sorts of orders without giving it a second thought. But in a Mahila battalion or in a female battalion wherein your troops are all females, so you cannot just pass on the orders just like this because you are dealing with mothers, you are dealing with sisters. There may be some personnel who are having some genuine problems. So for what the experience I have gathered is, it is difficult to command a female battalion as compared to a male battalion.
So are those cliches true? Do we carry too much of our emotional baggage into our work lives? Is that something that could be an obstacle?
No, it's not an obstacle, but actually we have to see that we are commanding human beings. They are human beings, and every human being has its own emotions and, you know, background. So we really have to, as a leader, as a troops commander, you really have to see or understand how your troops are feeling about a particular thing. So it's not a sort of a baggage. To become a good leader, you need to understand your troops' emotions also and sentiments.
Because my personal experience is when I joined the FMCG industry, fast moving consumer goods, and we were selling tail sabun, I was one of the only women in a lineup of many men. And they had never hired, Marico Industries never hired a woman at the sales level, at that level. I had to stand on my head to prove a point, in the sense I would do dumb things like when men would just do a quick beat during the first training period of being in the market till 2 o'clock and come back and sit in their air-conditioned distributor's office to prove a point that I had the stamina and I was tough as nails. I would be going on till 7 o'clock, never complaining whether it was my periods or whatever, because I would try that extra hard to show that I am in no way, in fact, if possible, I would be better than any guy on any front. And by the middle of that experience, I realize I'm exhausting myself, because proving a point is something that we don't need to do when we're working alongside. We have different skills, different things to contribute in a workplace.
You are very right, Sona, while saying so, that there is an extra burden on our shoulders to prove our worth. It's a social fabric which feels so. You know, we come from the same social fabric where everybody else is coming from. So they see and consider women as lesser, you know. So they have less physical power or mental power, or they are not prepared to undertake any, you know, a sort of a different job or think out of the box and all. But yeah, definitely, there is an added pressure on our shoulders to prove our worth. Like while we landed in Liberia also, so even the people, officials who were working in UN, they were quite apprehensive as to how we people are going to perform, because they said that, yeah, they'll be put through a test and let us observe as to how these people are reacting to a particular situation. But I was sure of my girls, I was sure of our training, and we did quite well after going there. So that is an added, pressure on our shoulders to prove your worth.
Girls, don't feel any pressure. You know, we don't live in those medieval times where the men need to go hunting and you need to be nurturing. Those roles are all wiped out. And it's a lot to do with the head, even when it comes to the military forces, because my dad always talked about how certain women, very few, I think the Indian Navy has double of the Indian Army at least, and the Air Force is the best because they have close to 14% women. So they are beginning to value the kind of skills that women do bring in onto the table. They are different from men. We don't have to be equal in being Xeroxes of each other. Copies of each other. But sorry, I'm not very good at this moderating thing and I might talk more than I need to. So I need to cut that there. I am on the other side. So Ishita, you are this young blood in the forces. You've joined in 2017. I understand that's all of 2 years. And she's posted in one of the most, I would say, a tough region like Bijapur, which is said to be the second most illiterate.
Yes.
That's a negative way of putting it, but you know, it's the truth. She has been pushing a drive out, which I read as hashtag
bleed bold.
I just wanted to ask her, a lot of people in Bijapur on Twitter, despite being illiterate?
It's not because that hashtag is not for the people of Bijapur. It's just to attract the attention to the problem that is there. See, Bijapur, it's the second least literate district of illiterate district of India.
Now, what's the language of Bijapur?
Bijapur, there is Gondi. People speak Gondi. There are mainly tribal people there. Okay. So, Bijapur is basically the Naxal hotbed.
Okay.
The left-wing extremism that you most of you must have heard about. It started, like, it is having its roots in Bijapur. So, Bijapur, it's tribal heartland. There are tribal people. And the level of ignorance and level of poverty, Sona, I would tell you, it's so astonishing there. The women there, they do not know that there is a concept of gynecologist. They do not know that there are female doctors. So, why I started this drive? Because when I went there on duty, first of all, when I was posted to Bijapur, when I joined my battalion, I was seen, as ma'am said, that they were apprehensive. Ki ye ladki aayi hai, abhi, like, what to do?
But that begs one question.
Yes.
I have seen a generation shift in every workplace in, you know, less than 5 years. I mean, forget about 5 years. In 3 years only, there's a big shift. And if you were a batch of, you know, much earlier than hers, 1987, and hers is a couple of years ago, I just wanted to ask, do you see, this is my personal take, I have the, you know, people keep cracking jokes about the millennials and the guys and girls in their 20s, but the guys in their 20s, I found them to be incredibly different from those in my generation, so to say. They do not feel that awkward and uncomfortable with the opposite gender, and there's a cool, you know, comfort in each other's company. So do you see that difference in terms of your batchmates who could be largely guys, considering there's only a 3% you know, of presence of women in the forces that you belong to?
In my batch, the batch, I am from the 50th batch, Dagos. In my batch of 51, we were just 4 lady officers there. And
how does it feel? Because I was in an engineering college with 6 women and 387 boys. I was made to feel conscious about everything. You know, why did I pop these breasts? Why did I have this body different from theirs? I was just made to feel uncomfortable.
See,
how was it for you?
It was not uncomfortable. You can say it was different at first because we were not, like, we were new to the place. We were new to all the training and everything. But later on, as we, like, ran together, we sweat together and everything, there is a level of comfort that comes amongst all the batchmates then. Then the main
thing... Was it the same for you, Seema? Or was it any different in your time?
To some extent, it is true. But as rightly pointed out by you, the current generation has changed a lot because
we are changing for the better.
Like I have grown up son and a daughter too. I have 2 kids. Both of them are. My son is working in a corporate sector, and I can see from his behavior and his attitude, like there is a lot of change which has set in this and which is the changes for better. Like when I joined in 87, situation was different. But I think for Ishita, it would be much easier. Maybe because of this, we have so many things to communicate. Like there were, when I joined, there were no mobiles, no telephones, nothing of that sort was available for us. But now even officer like Ishita, who is there in Bijapur or sitting somewhere in interiors, she has all the facilities to communicate with her dear and near ones. So, obviously,
girls,
it has made
how many
made
of
difference.
You want to join the forces? Is there anything more glamorous than a uniform? I mean, this is the most awesome, what would you call it, Kalul? Sartorial choice one could make, right? And camouflage is totally in, isn't it? On trend. Guys, you're not finding a, you know, there's a reason Barkha makes for a great moderator. I am just playing it by ear, and you'll have to help me along. I think both these uniforms look so fabulous. You know, big hand to women in uniform to start with. If you guys, since I'm a musician, I'm very tempted to tell you there's a brilliant song. Does anybody listen to metal music out here? Do you? So Metallica is another era ka band, but they have a song called Women in Uniform. Check it out. I don't sing in English, otherwise I'd belt it out for you guys. That is such a cool song. So Ishita, you were telling. So what were the challenges in putting out this campaign, Bleed Bold, which is about freeing the taboos of menstruation? I think Guneet is going to join us and talk about Period, the film, which won an Oscar this year. So I think it's a great time for you to tell us what's happening in the ground, grassroots.
See, the tribal land there, na, in Bijapur, basically there is a lot of ignorance, and because of ignorance, there are a lot of taboos. So when I went there and I went on duty once, so I saw a separate hut being made and a girl was like put in there. So we naturally go on area domination duties and everything. We venture deep into the villages and everything. There I inquired, ki, like, what is happening? So then I was told that that girl was on her period and she was like made to live separately from her main household. And then that's when it hit me, like, ki, I'm there as a force personnel and to fight off all these security issues and everything. But that was the day I realized that I can be a change maker there. I can bring a social change, like, without my knowing. Like, my presence made them feel so comfortable to talk, that those women, they some of them knew Hindi and everything, so they tried to explain me, like, what is the issues that they go through. And then that is what made me realize that I need to work on this too, besides my normal mandate for which I'm there. So that's when I started collaborating with the NGOs and everything. We started...
That's a big hand.
We started these awareness sessions and everything. So this campaign is still in a very nascent stage. We plan to take it further. We plan to install sanitary pad vending machines that will give pads for them for free. And more than that, we need to explain them that you have to use them, because they don't know. The level of ignorance is such, they don't know what to do.
Guys, I need to, I'm not known to be politically correct. And I've been obviously, there are some questions which might make you uncomfortable. So I'd like to at least state my opinions there. I believe the tribals, so to say, have a lot to teach us when it comes to many matters. And during especially the journey of Satyamev Jayate, when I was one of the EPs on the project, I figured that in terms of their mindset, even in terms of female feticide, they have some of the best ratios when it comes to men and women, because they do not believe in killing the female fetus, which a city like Mumbai, where I live in, when I was for that FMCG company trying to launch a baby care brand, I was shocked to know that the worst are in the higher economic strata, the ones who are, so to say, privileged and have the money not to treat, you know, the birth of a woman as some kind of a big issue. And the data there was shocking, that the tribals of our country actually truly have a lot to teach us. And even when it comes to the periods, and you mentioned the whole idea of using pads, I think while there's a whole hygiene issue that needs to be addressed, and it's a very complex issue, but what they do in the traditional time, you're from traditional times, is economically, I mean, environmentally much more, you know, I mean, viable, because you use cloth.
I'll interrupt you. They are into using cloth pads and everything also. Our intention is not to make them use the sanitary pads. Our main drive is to drive out the taboos. Like, right. I need to wipe out this differentiation that they make, that the girl is on a period or a woman is on period. She cannot fetch water, she cannot sleep in her house. I personally believe this is
hats
all
off
nonsense.
To you. It wouldn't be so easy.
It is not easy, but I know it will bring a change.
Seema and Ishita, just recently, because we live in volatile times where the world is so polarized. It's like you either stand for this side or that side. And I like to think I'm completely agnostic and apolitical, and I should be able to call out and feel as an artist and speak my mind whenever I have to. And I have been shocked in the last few months when there was this whole, I wouldn't say controversy, push for change that was happening with the Sabarimala, you know. And I must share this with you, the most unexpected of quarters, the so-called liberal, open-minded, progressive minds that I know in my life, have sat me down to fight with me about how, you know, I'm not understanding the deeper ethos and the background to why men need to feel clean and be free of women for a small period of their lives and take this pious journey to the Sabarimala Mandir. And, you know, the truth is, again, there will be a lot of women also who went and protested about, you know, because main to jab stage pe gaati hu na, and I shifted to Befikar hoke wo samne. Controversial topic. But you know what? We are carrying a lot of dogma from the past. We've been told to think a certain way, that it is a free choice for us to feel that this is a choice that we should be able to let, you know, ye purani baatein ho gayi, it's time to carve out a brand new future, and thanks to people like you who are doing the hard ground.
What I feel that everyone should get a chance to choose or any sort of career, wherever she is interested for. And there should not be any taboo or any kind of restrictions attached to that particular profession, whatever a woman wants to take. As far as this topic is concerned, Sabarimala, it's a debatable sort of an issue. Like, there are so many judgments on it. So we cannot really, you know, say our point of view at this forum. So there are so many issues wherein a normal person will say per se that there is discrimination, like this sort of a judgment is discriminatory, or that judgment was okay, or that this is pro-women and this is anti-women. So it's basically it's a debatable sort of a thing. Yeah. But of course, the power to choose lies with us, and that power we should exercise very cautiously.
I would love for you guys to ask any questions that you might have, because I can only imagine what it is to actually, year after year, you started off and you have a long way to go, but Seema has been at it for so many years, more than 2.5 decades.
I just wanted to share a story. You can call it a story, sure, or it's my personal experience. When we landed in Liberia, so there were around 120 female officers with me. So, you know, one of my sub-inspector's son was appearing for class 10th board exams. You know our present, how the Indian education system is. Class 10th board, matlab, agar bachche ka 90% se kam aaya, so that child is gone. Or 12th mein, he has to score more than 98-99% to get admission in some good college and Delhi University or so. So the class 10th board results were out, and she came to me. She said, ma'am, please, mujhe apne bachche ka result dekhna hai computer pe online. Kyunki us samay CBSE probably has started posting the results online. So I said, okay, you are welcome. So she came to my office. I just asked the roll number from her, of her child. She gave me a roll number. I just, you know, clicked and I just showed this screenshot to her. Look, your son has scored 94%. Her son scored 94% in class 10. She was so happy, but in, you know, the first thing her reaction was, "Arey, ma'am, certificate mein ma ka naam dala hua hai." That was because from this particular instance, from that year only, Government of India had decided to put mother's name on your 10th class matriculation certificate. So I started wondering, like, my mother's name is not there in any of my certificates. I'm an educated woman. But nowhere my mother name surfaces. Yes. But that was an eye-opener sort of a thing. That particular instance still reverberates in my mind whenever I, you know, think of that particular incident. Like the first thing she said, madam, ab toh maa ka naam bhi likhne lage hai. So these little things make a difference in your lives. So we have to actually find out as to what could be done to improve your how good a human being you would be. You have to really find out
That is a wonderful anecdote, because we normalize a lot of stuff in our lives and we assume that that's how it's meant to be, but it's for every day. I mean, awareness counts for everything, and making change doesn't happen overnight. Are there any questions? Do we have time for questions?
We have time maybe for one or two questions, just quickly. Just one or two questions.
Good afternoon, ma'am. So since you're a part of the army and the force,
paramilitary force.
Yeah. So I want to ask whether the generation transition has actually done away with the deep-seated gender role that is still expected of women, even though you are doing something which is more and beyond what a 9-to-5 job is. Are you still expected to have a family and tend to it the same way that previous generations are supposed to?
See, I'll tell you this, that we are not expected, but family or something is what we'll love to have. And to tell about the role and everything that we go about and the gender bias and everything, let me tell you that recently I was deployed for the Dantewada by-elections in Chhattisgarh. So the stretch that I was going on for duty every day, we used to have demining because there is ID threat there. And then we used to go for deep search in the jungles. So we conducted the elections peacefully. We had all the VIP movement and all the security forces movement there. And yesterday, from the very same place where we used to go out for duty every day, we found 60 kgs ID there. Whoa. 60 kgs of ID. And every day we went there and everything. And when that discovery was made, all my subordinates did was to call me and say, Madam, aapne bahut himmat dikhai. कि हमने पहली बार कोई ऐसी कमांडर देखी कि मतलब नक्सल वाले एरिया में शी लेड अस फ्रॉम फ्रंट. सो आई वुड लाइक टू से दैट स्लोली दिस चेंजेस एंड दिस जेंडर बायसेस आर वी आर डूइंग अवे विद इट एंड वी आर नॉट एंड एज यू सेड फॉर फैमिली एंड एवरीथिंग वी हैव टू हैव वर्क लाइफ बैलेंस. सो वी Since just because we are in force does not mean like we don't have any aspirations and everything. We do want to have
Ishita family. Is getting married next month only. Yes. She is going to start a family.
I must say one thing because I'm getting the chance to Barkha, if you might allow me. Ye work-life balance jab main sunti hu na mujhe bahut dar lagta hai because I have a whole team of young people in their early 20s. They're just out of college. They seek that balance in such a hurry and they're in such a hurry to go to that Starbucks and have a coffee and look cool. That guys, seek that balance a little later jab seek lo sab kuch.
And also we carry our home to our work, so we will carry our work to our home. I just, with everyone's permission, because we're kind of losing time, one of our rugby champions is also a police officer. I don't know if you know that. Can we have you on stage if you'd like to say something to... अगर आप कुछ कहना चाहेंगी, I know they're your seniors, but अगर आप कुछ कहना चाहेंगी, because you wear two hats, you're a national level rugby player, but you're also in the police force, अगर आप कुछ बोलना चाहेंगी, कुछ भी आप बोलिए खड़े होकर बोलिए.
मुझे तो ज़्यादा पुलिस का जॉब नहीं करने पड़ता है क्योंकि मैंने स्पोर्ट्स कोटा में ज्वाइन किया था. हाँ. तो इसलिए मेरा स्पेयर रहता है प्रैक्टिस के लिए. मैं लॉट्स ऑफ थैंक्स देना चाहती हूँ कोलकाता पुलिस कमिश्नर को जिन्होंने हमें ये परफॉर्मेंस लेवल तक जाने के लिए जितना हेल्प कर सकता है डिपार्टमेंट के थ्रू. सबसे ज़्यादा हेल्प ये लगता है कि प्रैक्टिस का टाइमिंग, वो हमको उन्होंने बहुत हेल्प किया. और नॉर्मली हमारा जब कभी कोई ओकेशन, कोई वेकेशन रहता है तो उस टाइम हम लोग का विदड्रॉ हो जाता है, तब हमारा नॉर्मल ड्यूटी करने पड़ता है. तो ये नॉर्मल ड्यूटी जब हम करते थे तो बहुत सारे इंसिडेंट होता है जी. लेकिन उसमें थोड़ा माइंड कन्वर्ट करने पड़ता है. जब मैं ड्यूटी करती हूँ तो कुछ अलग माइंड, जब मैं घर में रहती हूँ तो बच्चा संभालना तो अलग माइंड, जब मैं ग्राउंड पे भागती हूँ तो अलग माइंड. तो डिफरेंट स्टेज मेंटेन करने पड़ता है.
थैंक यू. एंड व्हाट आई एम गोइंग टू डू नाउ इज आई एम गोइंग टू से थैंक यू टू सोना फॉर बीइंग अ फैंटास्टिक मॉडरेटर बिकॉज नाउ आई एम अ बिट वरीड बिकॉज शी कैन सिंग एंड शी कैन डांस एंड शी कैन ऑल्सो डू माई जॉब. सो व्हाट विल आई डू? नो, आई एम जोकिंग. थैंक यू. सोना इज गोइंग टू बी बैक ऑन स्टेज बाय द वे गाइज इन अ कपल ऑफ आवर्स और लेस देन दैट. सो वी आर नॉट एक्चुअली डन विद हर. थैंक यू वेरी मच सोना. बिग राउंड ऑफ अप्लॉज फॉर सोना. एंड आप भी आ जाइए. थैंक यू. I just, we've been hearing some wonderful stories of the parents who have made their daughter's dreams possible. And I just want to see if on stage, Sona, you can walk down the ramp if that's okay, or there's a wing here. Your bag is back.
Ma'am, I belong to such a family, jisme mere matlab police wale bhi hain, family mein sab kuch hai. But I never stop any child or daughter or son. चाहे वो रेस में भाग ले रहे हैं, चाहे स्कूल में जा रहे हैं, कहीं भी जा रहे हैं, बट आई नेवर स्टॉप देम. इवन आफ्टर ग्रेजुएशन सी, जब इसको वहाँ पे जो ये कौन सी कंपनी आती है, जो प्लेसमेंट वाली कंपनी आती है ना, इसमें किसी में नहीं बैठी है. तो मुझे बड़ा दुख हुआ. मैंने कहा यार, इसमें मैंने ग्रेजुएशन कराया है, बी टेक कराया, इसमें बैठी नहीं, क्या हुआ है? तो एक दिन इसने बोली, पापा मुझे चांस दो, मुझे कुछ और तैयारी करनी है. मैंने कहा ठीक है, वेलकम. तो मैंने बिना किसी सोचे समझे इसको आईएएस की तैयारी कराया. ठीक है, उसके अकॉर्डिंग इसको अपना जॉब मिल गया है. तो लेकिन मैंने रोका नहीं कभी.
वेरी गुड. अब मैं आपसे पूछना चाहूँगी, डू यू फील व्हेन यू हियर दैट शी इज सर्विंग इन अ नक्सल हॉट ब्रेड, शी इज लीडिंग अ कंपनी ऑफ 135 मैन, डर लगता है?
या थोड़ा तो डर लगता ही है, पर यह है कि आई एम प्राउड ऑफ दैट शी इज डूइंग ड्यूटी एंड आई हैव फुल कॉन्फिडेंस इन हर कि वट एवर शी गॉट द ट्रेनिंग शी विल.
Ishita, would you like to add to how the role of your parents has been?
Let me tell you very honestly, I have had a very colorful childhood. My mom is a teacher, my dad is an engineer. And ever since I have been like woken up or like opened my eyes, I am doing n number of things. I have had dancing coaching. I am a I'm a trained Bharatanatyam dancer. I'm a TT player. I'm a university level TT player. And for everything, like for everything, I just had to look back and they were like, okay, go ahead.
Fantastic. I want to ask you something. In the morning you said that one of the most difficult things was to leave your child behind when you went to Liberia. How did you cope with that? Because women have too much guilt, ma'am. Or fazool ka guilt.
Haan, fazool ka guilt maan sakte hain, but at that point of time, it was really tough for me to leave my child. But since, as Ishita said, my parents were there, like my father is no more now because he died last year. But my father was very supportive and so is my mother. So both of them had promised me that they'll look after my daughter well. And they did so also. And I was totally, you know, dependent on them as far as looking after of my children, this part of my family was concerned. But that guilt, I don't know from where did it come, but sometimes it does come and it sets in your
psyche.
I
want to ask both of you one question. We're now seeing women as fighter jet pilots. We're seeing women lead the Republic Day parade. But the final frontier is still women in combat. In many ways, both of you have already done it. You've served, like an army infantry would in hotspots. And as I was mentioning, two women were leading from the front in the anti-terror ops in Jammu and Kashmir. Do you think that women are ready for full combat? Would you embrace that role?
I would like to say that my organization, Central Reserve Police Force, CRPF, here we have no glass ceilings to break. Ever since we joined the force, we are at par with our male colleagues. Whatever I do, they do. Like I lead in anti-Naxal operations, I am...
So you believe you're already doing combat?
Yes, we in CRPF, we are already in active combat role.
Even I believe so because way back in 1990, I was there in Srinagar when the situation was quite bad. And I have seen certain incidents happening in front of my eyes. So as far as CRPF is concerned, we have already into this kind of the combat roles. We have already doing this particular thing.
Yeah.
And
as far as the other services
also, they can also go for it. I mean, it's their decision.
I hope that we see more and more women in uniform.
So we people hope that to have more and more women
because
in uniform.
Because I can tell you that, you know, you're very, very inspiring for this generation of women. I'm going to say thank you to Renu and Anilji. Thank you if we can have you off stage. And now is the moment. Now is the moment that we formally honor both our women in uniform. Now, we've been seeing them felicitate people, but I think it's time to honor them. And I have two very special guests. You will be hearing later in the day from them. But at the moment, opening the doors for the dreams of women, iconic singer Usha Uttap. If we can have her on. And Tushar Kapoor, well-known actor. Please, if we can have both of you on. Can I request Tushar and Usha ji to just come here? Usha, you want to sit for a... Okay. Have the awards on stage. I'm going to request Usha Uttap ji and Tushar Kapoor to jointly, can we come in the center please? Jointly present the awards to our women in uniform, DIG Seema Dhundia and Assistant Commandant Ishita Chauhan. And a big round of applause. Big round of applause there. Let's give it up for our women in uniform. Also for Usha Uttap and Tushar Kapoor. And I just want Usha ji, we'll be hearing from Tushar in about 10-15 minutes from now. If you had a song that would describe women in uniform, what would those two lines be? Because I know you have a song for every occasion.
Yes, I do. Since I'm a police officer's daughter myself, and that too from Bombay, I would definitely say to everybody, remember that the policeman or the police is your friend. So I would say, you've got a friend. Yes. When the sky is Anna and you need some love and care, and nothing, nothing is going right. Close your eyes and think of me, and soon I will be there to brighten up even your darkest night. You just call out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running just like they would to feel you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you have to do is call, and they will be there. Yes, they will. You've got a friend. And you know something? This was not planned. Really not planned. I don't know. I don't even know how I thought of it. But I've always felt that the police is our friend. And the more we make them our friend, the more we can help society.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Tushar. Thank you, Usha. Both of them will be back on stage. We have a special surprise for you when it comes to Usha Uttav. So you have to wait till the end of the day to see it. Tushar is going to be talking about masculinity for the modern age and being a single dad in about 15 minutes from now. Really, truly mortal man. Yes.